Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. And it's a pleasure to be here with Bob. You know, this spring will mark 9 years for me in Houston. But before I was in Houston, I spent 4 years in Kansas City covering the Royals for their flagship radio station, doing pregame and postgame shows and taking calls about things like, will the Royals ever win a World Series? And the answer was yes, once I leave. So I got to know Bob when I was in Kansas City, where, of course, the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum is based. And if you're ever in Kansas City, definitely stop by. I would highly recommend it. Went to a few Negro League Baseball Museum events, and just being involved in baseball in Kansas City, it's pretty hard not to cross paths with Bob. I'm a little disappointed this is over Zoom, because the thing about Bob, every time I've been around Bob in person, he has always been the best dressed person in the room. And you're not really getting the full scope of that right now over Zoom, but just take my word for it. Bob Kendrick's always dressed to the nines. Good to see you, Bob.
It's great to see you too. It really is. And so, I'm excited to talk to the folks over at IABC, because in my former life, when I was working for the Kansas City Star, I was involved with IABC Kansas City. And I had to go and dust off. I had a couple of bronze quills down in the basement that I had to go dust off in preparation for this, because I was senior copywriter in the Kansas City Star's promotions department, which at that time functioned as its in-house advertising agency. So we were doing a lot of these kinds of pro bono campaigns for a lot of different not-for-profit organizations, including, Robert, the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, which is how I got introduced to the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, going way back to 1993. And I put together a campaign to promote the museum's first ever traveling exhibition that debuted in the storefront space here, right across the street from the museum. I'm sure you remember that space. And I think it was Danny's restaurant was probably in that space by the time you left. And that's what the museum used to occupy. And we debuted a traveling exhibition called Discover Greatness. Man, that exhibit is still touring the country to this day. That was 1993, 28 years ago. It is right now on display at the Yogi Berra Museum in Montclair, New Jersey. And so I put together the promotional campaign for that, and we drew some 10,000 people to historic 18th and Vine, August of 1993. And please understand, folks, there was nothing at 18th and Vine in 1993, except the Lincoln Building. And to draw 10,000 people to see this exhibit, I think it gave those early organizers of the museum a real understanding that, yeah, we might have something special. And then my involvement began there with the museum as a volunteer. And now I get to try to run the organization, but it's been 28 years of affiliation with this great institution.
And, you know, you mentioned about start coming over from the newspaper side with the Kansas City Star and getting involved with the Negro League Baseball Museum. And of course, you're very instrumental in a lot of their public relations and marketing efforts. And I guess just to start off, if you could just kind of go through a timeline of kind of not just your involvement with the Negro League Baseball Museum, and, you know, you became president in 2011, but as you said, you've been involved much longer than that. Just kind of your history with the museum, and also just kind of the history of the museum itself, because, you know, you mentioned the 18th and Vine neighborhood, which for those who don't know is a historic neighborhood in Kansas City, a Kansas City, for those who are familiar with jazz, a lot of jazz history was made in that 18th and Vine neighborhood. And, you know, there really wasn't a whole lot there for a very long time. And projects like the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum helped revitalize that neighborhood to the space that it is now, where it's a really nice place to visit with quite a few things going on. But if you could just kind of take us back into kind of that evolution of you with the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, and also the museum itself eventually becoming what it is and moving to the space that it is now.
Yeah, no, the Negro Leagues Museum folks started, believe it or not, in a little tiny one-room office here at historic 18th and Vine. And Robert did an amazing job of describing what 18th and Vine, what it meant to Kansas City, and particularly in its heyday, because it was literally a cultural crossroads where jazz and baseball intersected. But like a lot of urban communities, it had died. And when you delve a little deeper into the story of the Negro Leagues, you will learn that the demise of many urban communities are greatly attached to the loss of the Negro Leagues. So we really did not understand what we were losing when we lost the Negro Leagues, because we lost a spark, a catalyst that drove economic development in so many urban communities in this country. 18th and Vine was no exception. So it had been left to die. It had been abandoned. And here comes this little fledgling museum in 1990, establishing itself in a little one-room office, about a fraction of the size of my office. And I'll never forget the first day that I walked in and I'm looking for the museum. And at that time, a guy named Don Motley was the executive director. And I'm meeting with him in 1993 to talk about this promotional campaign that we're going to put together for the museum. And I walk into what I thought was just his office. And I said, well, I'm looking for Mr. Motley and I'm looking for the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. He says, son, you're standing in it. And it had a few pictures up on the wall. And guys like the late, great Buck O'Neill and other local Negro Leaguers who were still with us at that time, they literally, folks, took turns paying the monthly rent to keep that little office open. And that's how we got started. So we are as grassroots an institution as you will ever encounter. No one gave the Negro Leagues Museum any chance of succeeding. And I can understand why, because there was nothing else here. So the question is, who's going to come see you? There's no built-in foot traffic to drive attendance. And you're in an area that had the stigma associated with it, as many African-American communities face today. And unfortunately, perception is reality in the minds of so many. And so thanks to the infinite wisdom of the late, great Buck O'Neill, who defied all of our supporters. Some of our most ardent supporters were saying, don't do it. And Buck said, no, we will build this museum at 18th and Vine. When we build it, we will help resurrect what was once a very proud, prominent African-American community. But then when you stop to think about this, Robert, the origins of the Negro Leagues began right here in this community. Right around the corner from where we operate, the Paseo YMCA is where the Negro Leagues were signed into existence, literally a block and a half away from where the museum currently operates. So it really made a lot of sense that this museum be in Kansas City and it be at historic 18th and Vine. I entered a picture in 1993 as a wide-eyed volunteer who didn't know a doggone thing about the Negro Leagues. You know, I knew the name Satchel Paige and Cool Papa Bell, Josh Gibson, because I'm a baseball fan. And I do think that most baseball fans have at least heard those names. Now, they may not know how great these players were, but you probably heard those names. But man, I had no idea about the breadth, the depth, the scope, the magnitude that this history represented both on and off the field. And honestly, I became engrossed in it. I wanted to learn as much as I could, and I didn't want to keep it to myself. And then you started to meet the players, their spirits. And I know you've met a number of these legendary ball players over your time in this game. And they had such an amazing spirit, folks, because honestly, had any of them been bitter about the things that transpired in their lives as they were trying to play baseball in this country, I think every one of us would have said, you had every right to be bitter. But to a player that I've ever met, not one of them harbored any bitterness or expressed any ill will toward anyone who may have attempted to perpetrate something against them as they were trying to play baseball in this country. And I just found that to be such an endearing spirit. So now I'm falling deeper in love with this story. I had no idea that it was going to lead me down one of the most fulfilling, gratifying career paths that I could have ever embarked on. I just wanted to support this organization in any way that I could. And I volunteered for 5 years. And then I took a leap of faith. I left my corporate job to sign on to become the museum's first director of marketing in 1998. I served in that role for about 12 years, left briefly in 2010, and then 13 months later was coming back being introduced as the president of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum.
And the evolution of this museum, I mean, obviously your role has changed and has grown to the role that it is now, but also too, the museum itself, the space that it's in now, you know, I got to Kansas City in 2009. And by then you know, the Negro Leagues Museum was really starting, I felt like, to really kind of get established and in the space that it's in. How did you guys wind up going from that one room that you mentioned to the beautiful museum space that you have now?
Yeah, with a hope and a prayer, you know, because most museums start with an endowment already in place. And we did this one in such a non-traditional fashion. There was no seed money. You know, as I mentioned, these guys took the turn paying the rent to keep it open. But we started with a dedicated few who believed that this story deserved to be told. And we went out and we turned over every rock and every stone. And we convinced people that this was something that needed to be celebrated. It needed to be shared. There were so many amazing life lessons that stemmed from this story. And we raised the initial $2.5 million to be part of the museums at 18th and Vine Complex, which also houses, as you well know, the American Jazz Museum, our sister museum right across the hall. Again, uniting those two powerful cultures, two powerful cultural institutions celebrating baseball and jazz. And while on the outside looking in, it may seem like an odd combination, but when, again, you dive inside the story, you understand that those two went hand in hand. And we moved into our current home in November of 1997. And we've been in this space ever since. So we went from that one room office to now about 10,000 square feet of exhibit space that chronicles the story of Black baseball in America in general and the professional Negro League specifically. And along that journey, we've become recognized as America's National Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, as deemed and designated so by the United States Congress in 2006. So you can see it's been an amazing journey. And what I'm even more excited about is that Buck's prophecy was fulfilled. People are living and working and playing at 18th and Vine again. And I think we've only scratched the surface. There's still so much yet to come. And I'm excited that in essence, the Negro Leagues Museum has done for this community what Black baseball had done for urban communities across this country.
Now, you mentioned Buck O'Neill, and we cannot tell the story of the Negro Leagues, period, or the Negro Leagues Museum without talking about Buck O'Neill, who passed away in 2006. I think a lot of people first became aware of Buck O'Neill when I did, which was the great Ken Burns baseball documentary that was on PBS that originally aired in 1994. Buck O'Neill was a very prominent part of that documentary, not just talking about Negro League baseball, but talking about baseball, period. And he was someone that I know you were very close to. And he was maybe, I think, the biggest, the biggest proponent of the Negro Leagues and keeping that story alive. And you've been able to help carry that on, in part because, as you mentioned, you said you wanted to learn about the Negro Leagues and you wanted to share these stories and Buck O'Neill and what he was able to do and the stories that he shared with you and others is really a big part of the Negro League Baseball Museum and that history as well.
Oh, no doubt about it. I mean, Buck was the Pied Piper of the Negro Leagues. He was perhaps the game's greatest ambassador, because you hit the nail dead on the head. Because it didn't matter. He taught baseball, whether it was Negro League baseball, whether it was Major League baseball, college baseball, Little League baseball, it did not matter. There was no more tireless proponent for baseball than Buck O'Neill. And of course, the Negro Leagues Museum was his baby. And I was very fortunate, man. I was there. I was there for the ride. And when Ken Burns essentially introduces Buck O'Neill to America, he was 82 years old at that time. And he literally stole the show. If you haven't seen baseball, and Ken Burns, one of the great storytellers of the 21st century, man. I mean, he's just amazing. What Ken Burns and Buck O'Neill talked about this is that what Ken did was he allowed Buck to tell the story the way he remembered the story, where everybody else wanted to kind of steer the story in the direction that they wanted it or they thought it was. And so here was Buck O'Neill, this very charming, gentle man who was telling these wonderful stories to baseball fans that they never heard before. And Robert, he did it with a twinkle in his eye. and a smile that lit up the screen, and America fell in love with Buck. As I mentioned, he was 82 years old at that time. God blessed him to live for another 12 years, where he was literally gallivanting across this country, preaching the gospel of the Negro Leagues and the virtues of his museum to any and everybody who would listen. And guess who's along for the ride? Old Bob. And I guess I'm hanging on to the hem of his garment. And now I get to preach the gospel of the Negro Leagues and the virtues of Buck's museum to any and everybody who will listen. And it's an honor for me. It really is. As I mentioned earlier, to do this work, anytime you do something that you know is bigger than you are, and the fact that you have an opportunity to leave a legacy by leaving something that others will enjoy for years to come, that is as gratifying a thing as I think any of us could ever do. And so for me, we understand that we have that opportunity. And you can't feel Buck's shoes. There's no way you could step into those enormous shoes and feel them. I'm honored to be able to just step in his shoes and have his shadow, as I say, loom over me, where others would find the weight of his shadow. I see his shadow as protection. It guides my footsteps. And I tell people all the time, man, I talk to Buck almost every single day. It's probably not a day that I don't talk to Buck. Now, he doesn't always talk back to me, but I talk to him almost every day. We lost him, of course, 15 years ago in 2006, the same year that he was up for induction into the National Baseball Hall of Fame. And of course, he missed by one single vote in 2006. Coincidentally, he is back on the ballot again for Hall of Fame considerations 15 years later. And now I got to prepare myself all over again to go through this roller coaster of emotions. I'll be on pins and needles come December 5th, waiting at 5 o'clock Central Time for the news to come on whether or not Buck gets in or not. And so I'm excited, I'm optimistic, I'm nervous. You know, the emotions kind of span the gamut right now, but we certainly believe that Buck O'Neill deserves to be in the National Baseball Hall of Fame.
Absolutely. And, you know, obviously IABC is about marketing. And I want to talk about, you know, marketing the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. And what you're really doing is you're marketing the Negro Leagues and the history of the Negro Leagues. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the stories that you got from Buck O'Neill. He's not the only one. I mean, you have been fortunate enough to be in touch and communicate with pretty much all of the Negro Leagues players, yeah, who've been around, you know, many have since passed, like Buck, yes, but you know, have been around at least over the last, you know, 30 years or so. How big is that in terms of just being able to know these stories? And I mean, I've had enough conversations with you and heard you tell a lot of these stories and talk about the history. Do you write anything down? Do you have notes on any of these stories that anybody have told you? Or because a lot of the Negro Leagues is about word of mouth.
Yeah, no, and I don't write them down, you know, and people I'll come in to do presentations and people want to know, well, you know, where's your notes? And well, I don't have any notes, you know, and more times than not, I have no idea what in the world I'm going to say. I just get up and open my mouth and the words start to flow out. Now I'm getting older. And so I don't know how much longer I'm going to be able to do that. I'm going to have to start writing these stories down. But, you know, you touched on it. I got to spend time with Monty Irvin, who eventually lived and died there in Houston. The great Monty Irvin, who could have been the first to break the color barrier. Now, as a matter of fact, he was the Negro League's owner's choice. If anyone was going to break the color barrier, they thought it should have been Monty Irvin. Monty Irvin, folks, had the same pedigree that Jackie Robinson had, but to be quite frank, Monty Irvin was a much better baseball player than Jackie Robinson. Monty Irvin had been a superstar in the Negro Leagues, and Monty had gone to service like so many other Negro League players, and when he came out of service, Branch Rickey actually tried to sign him in 1944, and Monty was playing for a team called the Newark Eagles. They would eventually relocate to Houston and become the Houston Eagles after integration of baseball, because integration impacted those teams east so greatly. And they tried to relocate to Houston. Didn't last very long before they finally just shut it down. And so that Monty lived and died there in Houston. And so in 1944, Branch Rickey tries to sign him. Effa Manley, who owned the Newark Eagles, to say that she couldn't stand Branch Rickey, that would be putting it too mildly. She hated Branch Rickey because she saw what Branch Rickey was going to try and do. Branch Rickey was going to come into the Negro Leagues and essentially raid the Negro Leagues of his talent without any compensation to the owners. And so she was prepared to litigate against Rickey in his efforts to try and sign Monty Irvin. And Rickey backed off because he did not need the other owners to know what he was up to, because surely they were going to stand in solidarity and block this move. And that's when Rickey turned his sight to Jackie Robinson. Jackie Robinson gets his tryout right there in Houston, Texas with the Monarchs. Hilton Smith, the great Hilton Smith, who was from Giddings, Texas. Hilton Smith had seen Jackie Robinson playing at Fort Hood, and he had recommended Jackie Robinson to J.O. Wilkinson. Well, so many of the Monarch star players were off in service. And quite frankly, Robert, had the Monarchs had their full contingent of players, Jackie Robinson never would have gotten invited to try for the Monarchs. I don't think he would have made the Monarchs team, because at that time, Buck O'Neill is in the Navy, Subic Bay, Philippines. A guy named Willard Brown, Hall of Fame outfielder for the Monarchs, he's in the Army. Hank Thompson, who would integrate two major league teams, he's in the Army. And so if they've got their full roster, a guy named Ted Strong. Ted Strong, for those of you who are baseball fans, was Dave Winfield before we ever knew who Dave Winfield was. Ted Strong was 6'7" tall, freakish athlete, played every position on the diamond except for pitch and catch. Man, he's a 6'7" shortstop at one point in time. And when he wasn't playing baseball, he starred for the Harlem Globetrotters. You know, tremendous basketball player. He's serving. And so if they've got that full contingent, you know, Jackie doesn't make that team. He doesn't even get invited. And so as fate would have it, these guys are in the service. He tries out for the Monarchs. He makes the Monarchs. And little did the Monarchs owner, J.L. Wilkinson, know that he had just signed a man that was going to put him out of business. Because by the end of that 1945 season, Jackie was gone. And he had signed to go join the Brooklyn Dodgers. And the rest is history. By April 15, 1947, he takes that monumental step on the field as a member of the Brooklyn Dodgers, forever changing the game of baseball, but more importantly, as you well know, forever changing this country. And so all of that is brought through the lens of these legendary Negro League stars who certainly made history. They made history with the love of the game. They changed the game. They changed our country. But that was not their goal. They just wanted to play ball. They just wanted to play ball. They needed a form to express themselves and to show the world that they could play this game as well as anyone could play this game. And so the Negro Leagues provided that sanctuary for them. And it was built out of the spirit, as I say, of one small, simple principle. You won't let me play with you in the major leagues? Okay. I'll just create my own league. Uh-huh. And I remind people, when you stop to think about that, that is the American way. Yeah, you make a way when there seemingly is no way. So you won't let me play, I create my own league. And then there are those who will say that the league that I created was certainly as good, if not better, than the league that wouldn't let me play. And that's why this story is so powerful and it's so compelling and it's so inspirational. And I get to draw from all of those players that I've gotten to know through the years, and I've tried to be a sponge, man. You try to soak up as much of this knowledge as you can, and now I try to relate that back to them because there are only a handful of these players still with us. You know, we're losing them. And we knew that from the onset when we started this museum, that it was going to be a race, literally a race against time. The people that made this history, wasn't a matter of if, it was simply a matter of when they were all going to be gone. But even more so, the people who saw them play, you're going to lose them as well. And so every time you lose one of those individuals, that window of opportunity closes just a little bit more, and it puts that much more pressure on this museum to make sure that we document and substantiate as much of this information as we possibly can.
I know we have some questions in the chat. I'm going to get to those in a moment. And obviously, if folks have questions, feel free to use the chat feature to ask your questions. And I'll get to those here. I did want to ask you, before we got to some questions from the audience, about the last year and a half, 2 years with the pandemic. So 2020 was set to be a huge year for the Negro Leagues and the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, because 2020, the 100th anniversary of the founding of the Negro Leagues in 1920, as you mentioned, at the Paseo YMCA in Kansas City, not very far from where the Negro League Baseball Museum is now. And I, there was a logo produced. I think I bought it from the Negro League Baseball Museum online, actually, the hat with the logo that I wear from time to time, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the Negro Leagues. But then obviously the pandemic changed so many things, and it changed how you were going to be able to market, this 100th anniversary of the Negro Leagues. And I know one of the things that happened was the tip your cap promotion, which I participated in on Instagram at the time. If you could just kind of talk about some of the marketing efforts and some of the things you did with the pandemic and trying to basically change course when what you thought the 100th anniversary was going to look like wound up being completely different.
Yeah, no, man. I mean, I go back and I reflect on 2020, and it started off with so much promise, y'all, because we had spent a year prior putting together what we thought was an incredible game plan to launch a year-long 100th anniversary celebration to commemorate what we believe to be one of the most significant occurrences, not in baseball history, but in American history. And that was the establishment of the Negro National League here in Kansas City, February 13, 1920. And so on February 13, 2020, we go right back, Robert, into the Paseo YMCA, because, we're working to restore that old historic landmark and convert it into an education and research center in memory of the late great Buck O'Neill. So we go right back into the very building that gave birth to this story on the actual 100th anniversary to that date. And I've got with me, man, an all-star roster of distinguished guests. We've got Rob Manfred, the commissioner of Major League Baseball in attendance. Xavier James, who's the chief operating officer of Major League Baseball's Players Association, is in attendance. The Honorable Mayor Quentin Lucas, the great mayor of the great city of Kansas City, Missouri, is in attendance. My dear friend and your friend, the great Frank White, 8-time Gold Glove winner, now Jackson County executive, Kansas City Royal Hall of Famer, he's in attendance. We've got John Sherman, who had just bought the Kansas City Royals. Our brand new owner of the Kansas City Royals is in attendance, and Mike Kehoe, the Lieutenant Governor of the state of Missouri, all joining me to help commemorate this milestone. And Major League Baseball and the Players Association announced a joint $1 million contribution to the museum. We rolled out this year-long celebratory plan, which included, at that time, a national day of recognition. First time ever that all 30 Major League teams were going to honor the Negro Leagues on a single day. They were going to wear our commemorative patch, the patch that you're talking about that you got the cap with. They're going to wear that. And then we were going to stage in all the stadiums that day a tip your cap with players and fans. So the bulk of these events, the bulk of the celebration involved live events. Well, less than 30 days later, everything came to a screeching halt, just like that. Because we're shuttered now from a pandemic, a coronavirus pandemic. I didn't know what a coronavirus was then. I still don't know what a coronavirus is. I just know it wreaked havoc. And we shuttered this museum on March 14th last year, and we were fortunate enough to reopen June 16th. Well, our National Day of Recognition had been originally scheduled for June 27th. Well, as we wasn't even sure if baseball was coming back, no less be there to be played by June 27th, because baseball and the Players Association were still going through some rather contentious negotiations on if or when it was going to bring the game back. So it was pretty clear that this National Day of Recognition wasn't going to happen on June 27th. As I mentioned, we reopened June 16th. And I get on the horn and I call my good friend, the great writer, Joe Posnanski. And Joe is my brother. Now, we're not biological brothers, but we're as close as brothers. And anytime I have a bad idea, I vet that idea with Joe. And I called Joe. I said, Joe, I'm thinking about doing a virtual tip of the cap to the Negro Leagues to see if we can't maybe get a few former and current athletes, fans, maybe a few dignitaries join us in saluting the Negro Leagues by taking a picture or video of themselves and posting it on a site that we would create and then on social media. And I'm waiting, Robert, for him to tell me that's a crazy idea. We don't have enough time to do this. And he didn't say that. He thought it was a great idea. And then he reached out to his business partner, a guy, a tremendous communication strategist out of the DC area named Dan McGinn. And we vetted the idea with Dan. And he thought it was a great idea. And the three of us went to work. And folks, when we launched this campaign on June 29th, 2 days after the salute to the Negro Leagues would have happened, we launched it with four US presidents tipping their cap. President Obama, President Bush, President Clinton, President Carter, notables such as the late great General Colin Powell, Henry Aaron, transcending athletes like Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, Billie Jean King, Bob Costas, entertainers like Conan O'Brien, Stephen Colbert, the list just went on and on and on. And then y'all, when we literally went into outer space and got a tip of the cap from astronaut Chris Cassidy, who was aboard the International Space Station, I knew then that we had done something pretty doggone special, and this thing just started to reverberate and it went viral. And then the beauty of seeing kids in their Little League uniforms or their youth baseball uniform standing together, tipping their cap, because I think you know as well as anyone in our sport, there's nothing more honorable that a ball player can do than to simply tip their cap. It is the ultimate show of respect. And to see these kids embracing that spirit, saying, I see you. I understand what you did for our sport, and I want to acknowledge you. And then all of a sudden, we went from this feeling of doom and gloom to renewed optimism and hope. But I remind people that this, it embodies, it was incumbent of us to embody the resilient spirit of the Negro Leagues. You have to understand that these great athletes never cried about the social injustice. They went out and did something about it. So you know, as a steward of this story, you cannot wallow in self-pity. Now, I'd be lying to y'all if I told you that I wasn't doing some wallowing. There was some wallowing going on at one point in time, but you knew you had to kind of pick yourself back up and try to figure out how to make a way when there seemingly wasn't a way. And then all of a sudden we saw things shift, and the engagement level around the history and the museum just took off. And all these great things started to align and take place. You know, just last week, we unveiled the designs of US Mint commemorative coins, which we were able to get Congress to pass legislation last year, bipartisan legislation, in a contentious presidential election year. While it might not have been a miracle, it damn near was, though, because, you know, there's not too much bipartisanship going on in Congress, but the winning spirit of the Negro Leagues were able to unite both sides of the aisle. We just unveiled these designs of three commemorative US Mint coins that will be minted next year. And if we're able to sell through all those coins, we could raise some $6 million in support of this museum. So I want y'all to go out and buy that coin when they're available, you know? And, you know, but again, the momentum just started to shift. And then, as you well know, we get to December and Major League Baseball makes this epic announcement that it was at long last recognizing the Negro Leagues for what I already knew it was, a major league, and that it was going to roll into its history the statistics of the Negro Leagues. And of course, this reverberated around the baseball spectrum. And it just raised even greater awareness. We launched the crazy podcast that I'm doing called Black Diamonds, you know, over that time span this year in April. And so we find these interesting ways to communicate. And through that level of communication, it has really grown the engagement around this museum. And while we couldn't secure the level of corporate support that we would have traditionally have gotten in this case, the individual support has probably grown 3, 4, 5-fold over that time due to the communication tactics and strategies and the engagement that has resulted, you know, because of that.
Yeah, and by the way, that Black Diamonds podcast, if you're a baseball fan, it is definitely worth a listen. I've listened to a couple of them. As a matter of fact, Astros manager Dusty Baker has sat down for an interview with you for one of those.
We had such a good time.
Yeah.
We had a great time. Dusty, who is my guy. And I can tell you now, that World Series was just torment for me because I'm a lifelong Braves fan, but I'm also a huge Dusty Baker fan. And I really wanted Dusty to win his first World Series. And so it was kind of bittersweet for me. And I did. I had him on the podcast, and he was just amazing. We did the podcast on Henry Aaron. And of course, Dusty's there with the Braves as a rookie in 68. And he's there with Mr. Aaron as Mr. Aaron is going through this tumultuous time as he was chasing Roop's record. And the stories that he has about that experience. And for those of you who may not be aware of that story, that was 1974 when Henry Aaron broke Babe Roop's record. It was a record. He hit home run 715. Roof 714 had stood for decades. And honestly, it was a record that no one thought would ever be broken. And all of a sudden, here was this Black man in the Deep South approaching his record. And Mr. Aaron was subjected to death threats. He got nearly 1 million pieces of hate mail. And this is 1973, 74, y'all. We're not talking about a long time ago. And his family is in hiding. And he honestly does not know if he's going to make it around the bases when he hit home run 715 off my good friend, Al Downing. And you remember the two kids that run out on the field and everybody kind of gasped because they thought that they were out there to try and harm him. They just were there to celebrate. And there were snipers in the ballpark. And Mr. Aaron's personal bodyguard, Robert, carried a binocular case that he had draped around his neck. In the case is a .38 snub-nosed pistol. And when those two kids run out on the field, he reaches to open the case. And what is one of the most celebrated occurrences could have turned into one of the most tragic situations if someone had gotten trigger happy and shot those kids, you know? And as fate would have it, nobody did. And they weren't there to harm Mr. Aaron. They were there to celebrate with him. But it was such a painful period in his life. At a time when he should have been able to celebrate one of the most accomplished occurrences ever, it was more like relief. He wanted to get it over with. And it literally took him 25 years before he was able to exhale and then celebrate this amazing feat. And Dusty was there. Dusty's on deck when Mr. Aaron hits the home run. And he told him, he said, I'm gonna get this over with tonight. And he did just that. And like I said, I think for him, it was just relief, man. Now maybe they'll leave me alone now.
And great story. And, you know, I've gotten to know Dusty pretty well over the last couple of years as an Astros manager. 2 years I'll absolutely treasure getting a chance to know Dusty. And just a real quick story before, I swear we're going to get to these questions. We are. but just a real quick story about that moment and Dusty Baker. So we do an off-season radio show called Astroline, where we have interview players and current and former Astros players and coaches. And in spring training, we moved the show to a bar in downtown West Palm Beach. And I did a show with Dusty Baker last year in spring training, before everything shut down, obviously. And when I do the show, we have prizes like ticket stuff, coming games and things that we give away during the commercial breaks on the show that we give away to the people that are in the audience. And what I do to give away the tickets and the other things is I ask trivia questions based on whoever the guest is. So when we had Dusty, one of my questions for one of the giveaways was Dusty Baker was on deck for Hank Aaron's record-breaking home run. What did he do when he came to the plate after Hank Aaron hit the home run? And the answer is he drew a walk. So I asked the question, someone gets it right, I give him the tickets, and Dusty taps me and says, "Didn't I hit a double?" And I said, no, Dusty, I looked it up. I said, you walk. He said, "Man, I've been telling people all these years that I hit a double after Hank Aaron's record-breaking home run." And the truth is he did double. He had an RBI double earlier in that game, but he did not double after Hank Aaron's home run. I even told him, I said, "I'm going to double check, you know, and I'll tell you tomorrow. I'll make sure." But and I did, and he was very thankful. But yeah, he had been telling people for years that he hit a double after Hank Aaron's home run when he walked. Which, hey, there's no shame in that. But
President said when Henry Aaron hit the home run, everybody started leaving anyway.
All right, so we have a question here for you, Bob, and the question is: you know, over the past few years, we've seen a resurgence in Black pride and celebrating the Black diaspora. How, and especially you think about, you know, over the last year too, obviously with the murder of George Floyd and other and the protesting that was occurring, how has the Negro League Museum created marketing and communications campaigns to participate in this movement?
Yeah, no, it has been amazing. Actually, that's a great question because, you know, as if a pandemic wasn't enough, we move into a realm of protest and social injustice that was so much reminiscent of the 1960s. And all of a sudden, here's the Negro Leagues Museum right in the middle of it, but not in a bad way. It was in a manner in which people started to relate. Again, what we had always set out as our intent, they started to relate the fact that this museum is a social justice museum. It is a civil rights museum. It is just seen through the lens of baseball. But as I oftentimes say, more importantly, it is triumph over that adversity. Yeah, because you need that side of me too. And so all of a sudden we are in the midst of conversations. People were turning to us and me in particular for thought leadership around these issues of diversity, inclusion, and equity, you know, dealing with these issues of social justice, seeing young people embroiled in protest for the first time, and to see our baseball peers engaged in protest. And you have to understand why it was so significant to see baseball players doing this, because their locker rooms are not filled with Black players as it would be when you see for the NBA athlete and NFL athlete, there was almost an expectation that they would be on the front line. But for baseball, because such a small percentage of its athletes are American-born Blacks, you didn't know how it would participate. So for those guys, where many of them may be singular in those locker rooms, to stand out and stand up and say, "I got to do something about this," not knowing how your teammates are going to feel about your outward, outspoken nature as it relates to this issue. That took some moxie, but to the credit of virtually every one of those clubs, their white teammates, their Hispanic teammates, they all stepped up and they locked arms and arms together saying, "We gotta be better than this," because we do have to be better than this. And it was refreshing to see. But again, we go back and look historically. Who was in the front of social change? Baseball. Yeah, because when Jackie Robinson breaks the color barrier in Major League Baseball in 1947, that wasn't just a part of the civil rights movement, it was the beginning of the civil rights movement. And it changed things so dramatically in our society. And to see that we had started to move backwards in many respects was alarming. But also it was refreshing to see so many young people take on this challenge And I remember during a roundtable discussion, it was kind of rare for me to be on the other side, be on your side, to be interviewing and listening to these young players talk so passionately about doing the right thing and using their platform. It was refreshing to see so many young people engaged in this manner. And I was genuinely excited that the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum could serve as a buffer. And if the winning spirit of the Negro Leagues could help heal, then that just adds even greater a value to what this institution is all about. Because at the crux of the story is a vivid demonstration of why diversity, inclusion, and equity are so important, and how they can absolutely be a bridge toward tolerance and respect. And through the lens of the story, we learn so simply that we just have so much more in common than we do differences. But we also learn that our differences are not things that we should be running from. We should be embracing them. They are the things that make us unique. And we kind of demonstrate that through the lens of baseball. And so it's a powerful way in which we were able to open up even greater conversations in and around a topic that is so difficult. We don't like to talk about race. We just don't. And I do think if we don't talk about it, we feel like it ain't happening, but we know better than that. And so our goal is to make sure that people are comfortable being uncomfortable as it relates to having to talk about race. And we can do that through this vehicle known as the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum.
Absolutely. And I thought you brought up a good point earlier about the fact that, you know, so often we hear about adversity, and the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum is certainly about that, but it's also about triumph. We don't always hear about the triumph over the adversity. Yeah. And that's very much of the story of the Negro Leagues.
Oh, there's no doubt, because Robert, I don't want the only image of me to be the downtrodden side of my journey toward equality. No. You need to know my success stories as well, because there's not much commonality in that downtrodden aspect of it. Not too many can relate to what we've had to endure as enslaved people. And then the quest for justice where police dogs are released on us, the water hoses sprayed on us, the police brutality that has still continued to manifest itself to this very day. Those have been well documented, but my success stories are rarely ever talked about. And the Negro Leagues are one of those great American success stories. So I think you got to have a well-rounded view of my journey as a people to understand. You know, I know there might be empathy and maybe even in some cases sympathy, but it's hard to relate to something that you never experienced. And so I think a lot of times, you know, we kind of believe maybe they exaggerate. It ain't that bad. And then you see this with your own eyes. But here we take that adversity, as you mentioned, and we set the stage with it, but now this is about what they did to overcome the adversity, and that's the real story. And I think that's why this story is so important. It can be used as a vehicle, and the life lessons that stem from this story are maybe as prevalent and important as the history itself that created these life lessons.
Great stuff. And we don't have a whole lot of time left, but I did want to ask you about one more thing before we let you go. There's an independent league team that plays in the Kansas City area. They technically play in Kansas City, Kansas, just across the border from Kansas City, Missouri. They were known as the Kansas City T-Bones. They are now known, as of this past year, as the Kansas City Monarchs, which as many who are fans and big history buffs about baseball know that the Kansas City Monarchs, one of the legendary Negro League teams, that was the Negro League team that Jackie Robinson played for. If you could just talk about that partnership and how that came about with that independent league team, the Kansas City T-Bones, now Kansas City Monarchs.
You know, Robert, I could lie to you and tell you it was my great idea, but I'd be doing just that, lying to you, because it wasn't my idea. Mark Bradmeyer bought the team last year, and of course COVID hit, and he couldn't even have a season. And so near the end of last year, he reached out to me with an epiphany. He wanted to know what my thoughts were about him rebranding the team as the Kansas City Monarchs. And I'll be honest, initially, I didn't think much of the idea because, as you well know, the Monarchs are really our flagship brand. I mean, that is what we hold so near and dear to our heart because they were so great. Because, folks, we're talking about not one of the great baseball franchises in Black baseball history, but we're talking about one of the greatest baseball franchises in the history of our sport. One losing season in their almost 40-year existence in the Negro League sent more players to the major leagues than any other Negro League franchise. They were a model organization. And of course, it's our top-selling brand through our licensing program. People love the Kansas City Monarchs. And so I was a little apprehensive about this. But then as Mark started to lay out his business plan, and I got to know them a lot better. And then, Robert, the understanding that for any history museum in particular, and even more so for a cultural institution like ours, it really is about establishing relevancy. How do you make this history relevant? And so, yeah, this historic brand was special, but now it comes to life through these young athletes who are still dreaming of getting to the show. You know, the American Association, because of the Major League Baseball cutting so many minor league systems, now it has kind of generated a bunch of players who are still kind of dreaming of getting to the major league. So the quality of baseball grew exponentially. And so every time those kids put that uniform on, they are teaching now. They are introducing this story. And we were able to put together a significant business partnership that will be in place for likely the next 30 years unless something happens with the team. And there's annual revenue that comes to this museum. As part of this deal, we get a percentage of every ticket sold, every concession that is consumed from the gift shop. And they are dedicated to creating displays and other things to help teach the significance of this history. And then they are literally barnstorming throughout their league, also helping people understand the richness of this league and the importance of this museum. So all of that really started to resonate and made a lot of sense. And as fate would have it, because I told him now, I said, look, if you're going to call yourself the Kansas City Monarchs, you got to win. You cannot lose and wear the Kansas City Monarchs. Oh, I'm taking my name back. And as fate would have it, they won the championship in their inaugural season as the Kansas City Monarchs. So I guess the winning spirit of the Monarchs resonated through those young men. And I can tell you this, I went out and spoke to them opening day. And we talked about what it meant to wear that Monarch uniform. And that it was absolutely not lost on them. Matter of fact, I think earlier in the season, they felt the weight, the historical weight of wearing that name. And then they got their footing underneath them and they played great baseball. And they were able to win the championship in year one. And we're looking forward to many, many years of great success and helping people introduce this story to as many young people as we possibly can.
All right. Is this guy a great storyteller or what?
Unbelievable. I think the entire time I texted a few people and I said, I'm nerding out right now with this conversation. But I want to thank, everyone for attending the session, whether you're watching it live or on recorded on YouTube, on Facebook, or any of our social media platforms. But special thanks to Bob Kendrick for joining IABC Houston and Robert Ford for moderating the conversation. And I think we could all agree with Robert's sentiments early on that we wish this was in person, because I can imagine this carrying over to 5 o'clock happy hour as well and having the conversations over a few beers. But I want
to
thank
y'all will just have to invite me to Houston, man. It's one of my favorite places. So
hey, we'll have you back.
Have to invite me to Houston. We'll do it all over again.
I love it. Well, I do. We've got 2 minutes left, and I want to give you both an opportunity really quick to plug any social media handles and maybe Bob give some insights on when the museum is open and maybe how people can learn more.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You can learn more about the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum on the World Wide Web at NLBM.com. You can follow us on Twitter at NLB Museum KC. Same username on Instagram. And if you're so inclined, you can follow me on Twitter at NLBM Prez, P-R-E-Z. And that's the same username on Instagram as well. And we're constantly updating with things that are happening in and around the museum. Also want to be mindful that next year marks the 75th anniversary of the breaking of baseball's color barrier. And so we've got some very special things that we're going to be doing next year. But if you're so inclined, we'd love to have your support. Consider becoming a member of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. Make a donation to the museum. Buy some merchandise from the museum. There's so many different ways in which you can support.
That's amazing. And I was going to say, Robert, you've got the offseason coming up. So,
yeah, RA43 on Twitter and Instagram, if anybody is interested. And also, I'm going to plug Bob's Black Diamonds podcast, which I mentioned earlier. Definitely check that out. If you're a baseball fan in the baseball history, it's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, definitely check it out. And we'll drop, if you're watching this, I guess, retroactively, we'll drop that link in the show notes. So Bob and Robert, thank you so much for joining IABC Houston today. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me. It's great to see Robert. And it was great to talk to the folks. And I do look forward to joining you guys for a future opportunity somewhere down the line.
Absolutely. Well, I hope everyone enjoys the rest of the day. And we'll see you next month for the ESIG meeting at La Griglia. Take care, everyone.